Kevin, let's talk about the United Nations. Yesterday, a special high-level session was held to commemorate the 75th anniversary of the organization. Leaders from across the world spoke through recorded messages as the COVID-19 pandemic had seriously affected the occasion. A key theme of this session was that multilateralism was not an option but a necessity, a message that is increasingly under threat as the United States tears up the framework that has held the global community together for decades. Incidentally, President Donald Trump, who was supposed to be the first speaker from the international community, did not make any recorded remarks, although he was supposed to. We speak to Abdul of People's Dispatch on some of these issues.
Well, thank you so much for joining us. So the special session, high-level session was held yesterday. Many leaders took part, Donald Trump did not. And multilateralism was a key theme in those discussions, or at least they claimed it was a key theme. So what are your first impressions about the kind of speeches that were delivered yesterday? Was it just a symbolic occasion, or was there even the possibility of something more, you know, some kind of a reassessment of a UN's role?
I think all the speeches, if you see, including the General Secretary and other the President of the General Assembly, all the speeches are hinting towards one. The kind of politics which are happening at the global level, where the superpower, the United States of America, has taken a firm stand. It is moving towards unilateralism, and in the last few instances, we see, starting from the withdrawal from the Iran deal, Iran nuclear deal, to all the instances, including the withdrawal from the WHO, that particular way the United States policy, foreign policy, has taken the turn, it basically, most of the leaders are reflecting indirectly to that. They can't say, they could not take the name. But I think that is the central consideration, central concern for all the people in that yesterday's meeting.
Yeah, and this seems to be irrespective of ideology, irrespective of where they stand, because there is clearly a feeling that the UN is in deep danger if the United States continues like this.
Exactly. If you see the world leaders, there is China, which has a clear stand on it. Then there is France, which is a close ally to the United States. Then there is a Turkey, which is a member of NATO, and one of the who is also talking about multilateralism, how it is becoming an issue. And then there are other countries, if you name it, or most of the leaders took it as a central concern. They're talking as if the world is moving towards a situation which was similar to what was there before the first, second World War, which basically created the catastrophe. And to avoid certain such similar things in the future, the United Nations was built. So the basis of the United Nations was that no matter what our disagreements are, we will sit together and we'll try to resolve it through in this multi. This is the forum on which we will resolve our issues. But in last 5 years, it is longer than that, but at least in last 5 years, there is a decisive shift from this particular approach. And that is a very, very big concern. The chances of global conflict, you can see whether it is South China Sea, whether it is the Mediterranean, whether it is Africa, whether it is in West Asia, wherever you see in Venezuela, in Latin America, you see that the chances are increasing, and everywhere, a particular country, the United States of America, is basically creating, violating all the international law. Violating all the procedures which have been established, tested in last 70 years, 75 years, and basically going unilateral. Yeah, so that is the basic concern.
Right. So in this context, also larger questions about the role of the UN itself, like you pointed out, the last 3-4 years have maybe really exposed the kind of issues they have. But even before, like you said, there have been many concerns. The UN was not able to stop the invasion of Iraq. Many other conflicts, you know, imperialist intervention in so many other countries that has not been able to stop. And ever since the fall of the Soviet Union, there is an increasing question as to how much credibility it has beyond being a symbolic organization. So how do you see that in today's world?
I think the United Nations has, in last 70 years, it is true that in many, many instances, United Nations has failed to intervene decisively, play its role. And that primarily because of the structure of the United Nations Security Council. One of the main reasons which most of the leaders, while talking about reforms, the necessary reforms of the United Nations, they highlighted this issue. That one of the basic problems with the United Nations has been the nature of the United Nations Security Council, where some powers can veto all the multilateral actions. And that is basically a concern. So if that, those reforms are a greater issue, and I think certain countries, you see, you highlighted the failure of United Nations during the Iraq war. Similar things can happen today also. For example, the Pompeo's boasting about how rest of the countries, whether they agree with or not, they have to follow the sanctions which America has imposed on Iran. And that is their duty. So I think those things, those concerns are valid. And when the leaders are talking about reforms, the reforms, necessary reforms, I think Chinese president has highlighted that how the third world, the developing countries need to be reflected more into the Security Council, in the decision-making processes. If those things are taken care of course, United Nations, there will be always a problem. I think United Nations General Secretary has highlighted it correctly, that United Nations will be strong only if the members of the members want it to be strong. So if those reforms are taken, and those reforms are taken seriously, I think the United Nations will be able to handle whatever challenges.
Right. And finally, Abdul, a quick question on the sanctions on Iran also, which were announced yesterday, almost with symbolic value by the United States. So could you just talk a bit about what they imply as well?
I think, of course, it has a symbolic value. So if you see in the United Nations Security Council, where according to the UN Security Council Resolution 2231, the U.S. wanted the Security Council to take this issue. But I think Security Council rightly agreed that this is not the issue because U.S. is not a participant. But still, U.S. went ahead and said that because 1 month notice period has lapsed, now the sanctions are automatically imposed, which is, I think, it shows a complete disregard of, again, I'm repeating, a complete disregard of the procedures, the laws, the ways the international politics, the United Nations function. This is complete violation, but because the US is the superpower and it thinks that it can do anything, and also because of the reason that US has a control over the world finances, the exchanges and everything, the other countries might be forced to take a step back and not to a kind of, that will be a defeat for the United Nations itself, because as per the UN resolution, the sanctions against Iran should not be imposed. So this is a completely unilateral move, but because this is a superpower and which has a control over the global finances, it has at least the power, theoretical power, to impose its sanctions, and which will very much in effect will be a multilateral sanction, UN sanction thing. Though theoretically not, but in reality it will function like that.
Because countries won't want to antagonize the US.
Exactly. So that can be, that is another example of, this is a repeat of what happened in the Iraq war, in a different form, of course, where US went ahead without taking any consideration of what United Nations is saying. And similar thing is happening now. And that is happening only because the imbalance or the differences, the gaps in international politics, where the US has the military and financial capabilities where it can impose, as George Bush said, either it is my way or highway. That is a similar thing which are happening.
Thank you so much, Abdul, for talking to us.
In our next segment, we bring you part of an interview with former Secretary General of the Lok Sabha, PDT Achari, on the way in which the farm bills were passed in the Rajya Sabha and the action taken against MPs who protested. He talks about the trust breakdown that has happened between the government and the opposition.
I want you to explain to the viewers of NewsClick what you make of this unruly scene that took place.
The unruly scenes and ruckus, pandemonium in the house is nothing new. This used to happen in the Lok Sabha quite often, and it used to happen in the Rajya Sabha to some extent. So there is nothing extraordinary about the ruckus in the house. Yesterday, actually, there are two things which are which are important when we look at yesterday's happenings in the Rajya Sabha. One is that the House extended its sitting beyond 1 o'clock. They were to adjourn at 1 o'clock. The chair extended the sitting. Normally, there is a consensus built up on extending the sitting. If there is no consensus, that means if the opposition does not agree, then the sitting is not extended and the House adjourns. That used to be the practice all through. But here, what I understand is that yesterday, the House sitting was extended without there being a consensus. And the opposition, naturally, they shouted and so on. But the proceedings went on. And during this extended time, the minister was asked to reply and the reply was given and then all the rest of the things happened. So why the chairman or the government thought it necessary to pass this bill yesterday itself by extending the time actually is not known. They could have passed it today by accommodating the views of the opposition. That is what normally is done in parliament, because nothing will be lost. The government has majority in any case. You know, in the Rajya Sabha also, they are the largest single party and the other parties are there to support them. So they have nothing to fear, so far as the fate of the bill is concerned. But then the only problem was that they wanted to pass it yesterday itself.
No, if I may just interrupt you, sir, what was the urgency? And what was the urgency of the deputy chairman, Mr. Harivansh, wanting to pass those bills on Sunday itself? This is something we are unable to understand. At the same time, does the chair, in this case, the deputy chairman, is it not within his discretionary power to decide to extend the session or not? I mean, after all, there is no rule or that binds him to that. I mean, it is his discretion, is it not?
Actually, it is not his discretion. It is the decision of the House. That is a consensus. There is a sense of the House taken on such issues. The sense of the House is taken. That is what I said earlier, that if there is no consensus, if the members in the opposition say that they don't agree to this proposal, then the chair adjourns the House. Chair would say that since there is no consensus, we are not going to sit beyond the scheduled time of adjournment. That is the normal practice. But yesterday, I do not know why no effort was made, no effort seems to have been made to bring the opposition on board, and then extend that should have been done. That is a normal practice that is resorted to or followed in the legislature, particularly in parliament.
Mr. Achari, there were also some other developments that were unusual. Now, before the voting took place, after all this ruckus, the opposition wanted physical voting. They wanted individuals who are present to cast their vote. However, the deputy chairperson decided to go along with a voice vote. Is this also unusual, out of the ordinary?
So far as the voting procedure is concerned, things are clear. According to the voting procedure, when the debate is over, the chair puts the question before the House. For example, the chair would say, now the question is that the motion be adopted. There is a motion before the House. Everything is presented before the House in the form of a motion. So he would say that the question is that the motion be adopted. Those in favor say aye. So some people will say aye. And those against may say no. Some people will say no. Then the speaker, will, the chairman will say, I think the ayes have it. He will say that. And he stops there. Then a member, mostly from the opposition, stands up and says, noes have it. Noes have it. That means he is challenging the decision of the chair. He wants a division. Then the chairman would say, let the lobbies be cleared. And the lobbies are clear for 3 minutes. Then all the members who are sitting in the lobby and all that, they will come into the house. They will be ready for voting. He will repeat it again. Those in favor may say aye and no. And then people will say no, the noes have it. Then he will say division. And then the members will press that button. The voting will be done. This is the process. Now, the question is, can the chair ignore a demand for voting? Voting means the division, actual voting in the House. The other is voice vote. Whether the chair can ignore a demand from members for a voting in the House, I would say chair has no authority, no power to ignore a demand from the members for an actual voting in the House. He has to, under the rules, he has to. The reason is that under Article 100 of the Constitution of India, the issue that is before the House, any question that is before the House, is decided by a majority of the members present and voting. Now, as you know, the majority can be decided. Majority is a very precise thing. Majority in terms of number. Otherwise, you cannot decide majority. Majority has no other meaning. Majority has to be decided in terms of the number. So that is determined by voting in the House. That is what the Constitution says. So Constitution is very clear. But the practice of voice vote is there, is followed in all the legislatures. When there is a presumption that the government has majority, it is okay. So we can pass it by voice vote. But if there is a controversy, and if there is a demand from the members that there should be a voting in the House, then the chair cannot ignore that, and the chair has to proceed to conduct the voting in the House.
That's all we have time for today. We'll be back tomorrow with more news from the country and the world. Until then, keep watching NewsClick. We'll be right back.